Greetings, brothers and sisters, once again, in the name of Him who is our Redeemer, Liberator, Savior, and our Lord, who I hope and God knows I pray that you are still worshiping and serving every day and not simply on Sunday. For once again, this is the day the Lord has made, and we will and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. For those of you who haven't quite caught on yet, you are worshiping at the historic Lynch Street Christian Methodist Episcopal Church, 2175 John R. Lynch Street, in the historic capital city of Jackson, where we are still making disciples one by one in the 21st century, seeing Christ in everything we do, and everybody is somebody. Sit back, relax on this Martin Luther King Jr. Day Eve, and worship with us today. We're so glad that you joined us. God bless you and be blessed.
Mercy enduring forever.
are good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Amen. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith. In whom do we believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. As the music plays very softly and very appropriately, let us now go to the throne of grace together. What a friend we have in Jesus. All of our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege it is to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit, and oh, what unnecessary pains we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Lord, we praise you, we honor you, we glorify you, we magnify your name, for it is you and you alone that's worthy to be praised. Now, Lord, if everybody was like me, we all have sinned and fallen short of your glory. We've done it today. We sin through thoughts, words, and deeds. But Lord, we thank you. We thank you for grace. We thank you for mercy. And we thank you for the forgiveness of sins. Now, Lord, as we move forward in 2021, it has come in with a bang that once again we cannot explain. We've experienced on January the 6th one of the worst experiences, or one of the most gruesome days in American history. And Lord, even on January 13th, where there was a second impeachment of the President of the United States, we're going through. But you did tell us, Lord, as we go through, and then with the coronavirus at its highest, as you know, Lord, because you made this world and general and the United States in particular, that in the state of California in general and Los Angeles County in particular, one out of every three persons contract the coronavirus. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us, Lord, from all of our sins. Confirm and strengthen us to all goodness. And Lord, please bring us an everlasting life. It is in the matchless, miraculous, mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. Our scripture today, we're going to go right into it. Two passages of scripture, the second of which will be our main scripture for our sermon today. The first is coming as we think about this pandemic that's still going higher and it's getting worse before it gets better right now. But I do want to share the passage, one of my favorites, if not the favorite, in Isaiah 43, 1 through 4a. Isaiah, the 43rd chapter, 1 through 4a. And if we're honest, all of us have gone through trials, or will go through trials and tribulations in our life. But the God said through the prophet Isaiah that we can triumph in our trials. Isaiah 43, 1 through 4, he says, "But now thus says the Lord, who created you, O Jacob, formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine." Verse 2 says, when you go through the waters, with an S, I'll be with you. It can get worse. And when you go through the rivers, we're going to go through plenty of rivers in our life, they won't overflow you. And I hate to say it, but it can also get worse before it gets better as we think about this pandemic. But when you go through the fire, it will not scorch you, nor will the flame consume you, because I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I've given Egypt as your ransom, Seba and Cush in your place. So since you are precious in my sight, I love you. That's our Hebrew Bible, Hebrew text. But for our text today, with respect to our sermon, will be found in Acts chapter 5, 25 through 39. But the emphasis will be on verses 38 and 39. But to understand the context, we need to look at verse 25 through 39. And I'm only going to read it one time, so that I won't have to read it again when I begin the sermon. This is the text for the sermon, Acts 5, 25 through 39. There we read, "Then someone came and said, 'Look, the men you put in jail are standing in the temple courts teaching the people.' At that, the captain went with his officers and brought the apostles. They did not use force because they feared that the people would stone them." Verse 27. "The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. 'We gave you strict orders,'" you, what are they talking about? Peter and the apostles, "'not to teach in the name of Jesus.'" Strict orders. "Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Verse 29. "Peter," here it is, "and the other apostles replied," here it is, watch it, "'we must obey God rather than human beings.'" I just said something very important. We must obey God rather than human beings. "The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as prince and savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so it is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him.'" Verse 33, "And when they heard this, they were furious and wanted to put them to death. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, who was honored, very important, by all the people, he stood up in the Sanhedrin and ordered that the men be put outside for a little while. Then he addressed," after the folk went outside, "he addressed the Sanhedrin, 'Men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do to these men. Some time ago, Theudas appeared claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men railed to him. Watch this. He was killed. All his followers were dispersed, and it came to nothing.'" Verse 37. After him, Judas the Galilean appeared in the days of the census and led a band of people in revolt. He too, Quintus, he also Songbird, he also Sister Pinky and all of you out there, he also was killed and all his followers were scattered. 38 and 39 is very important. Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, let me stretch the muscles of my imagination. I'm trying to tell you now, leave these men alone. Let them go. Don't bother with these folk. I'm stretching the muscles now. Some of these folk know God. You better leave these folk alone. Listen, 44 plus one, excuse me, leave them alone. I'm trying to tell you now, leave them alone, let them go. For if the purpose or activity of these human beings in the United States, around the world, if they are of human origin, meaning that there's nothing but humans and they only care anything about themselves, they gonna fail. But if it's from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourself fighting against the very presence of Almighty God, the Word of God for the people of God. Thank you so very, very much, my brothers and my sisters. And now we have a selection, and we will then proceed on with our service today. Come on now. excited when you said be a witness, because I'm definitely a witness for Jesus, and I'm a witness for the Lord. Amen. Oh, man. Amen. Amen. Go ye therefore. Go ye therefore. Be a witness. Be a witness. Be a witness. We are to tell somebody about the goodness of Jesus Christ. I'll say that again. What we singing for then? What we singing for? Amen. What we singing for? We're not going to be a witness. What are we doing? We telling folks to stand up and be a witness. Stand up and be a witness. Stand up and be a witness. Yeah.
Stand up and be a witness. You shall be.
Don't be ashamed.
Don't be ashamed.
Oh, well, if you're ashamed before me, if you shame of me down here, Jesus said, I'm going to be ashamed before my Father, which is in heaven. So you don't want that to happen. Because, Brother Quinn, all of us striving to get to a place called heaven. Amen. I greet each of you again in Jesus' joy. My brothers and my sisters, we have heard a very, very strange things that happened this week that I didn't think that would ever happen. And we already talked about that last week. But then again, we had our president, the president of the United States, up until about 6 days from now, for the second time, had been impeached. That has never happened in 240-year history of the United States of America. We're going through some trying times, so I want you to join me. For those of you who don't know what's going on or confused, you're not supposed to be confused, because confusion is of the devil. Let me make sure that I say that word, confusion. C-O-N-F-U-S-I-O-N, confusion. Confusion is of the devil. There's nothing Christian. There's nothing good, there's nothing great, there's nothing spiritual about the word confusion. I get my antennas go up when I hear people say sometimes, I'm really confused, I'm really confused. That's nothing but the devil has entered at that time. And we gotta watch that word confusion, because the devil is the author of confusion. Amen? He's an author of it. He's a deceptor. He's a person who's the author of deception. So if there's any kind of confusion, okay, wait a minute, hold it. Now, I know these are my pastoral remarks, and I'm getting ready to let it go in a few minutes, because I'm getting ready to say a word from our sponsor. Why would God, let me just throw this at you, Brother Quentin. Why would God, who the God of love, confuse God's people? I'm just asking. We don't have to get deep in it. I'm just asking a simple question. Why would God be a God that confuses God's self? Well, wait a minute. Now, that sounds a little weird. No, because we are of the body of Christ. That means that we are connected to God. So the only being that God has to carry on the kingdom is us. Y'all hear it theologically now. He don't have no hands but our hands. He don't have no feet but our feet. He don't have no ears but our ears, no nose but our nose, no eyes but our eyes, no brain but our brain. God is a spirit. And they that worship him, that's connected to him, must worship him in spirit and truth. So because God is connected to us and we are connected to God, for God to confuse us, that means God is confusing God's self. I'm not trying to tell y'all to go to ITC, the seminary, but I'm just saying these are the kind of things that would come up if you were in seminary. These kinds of theological questions. And we would certainly critically think about that. God is a God of love. God is not a God of confusion. There's a lot of confusion in the United States right now. And what we as Christians have to do is know how to deal with that when it comes to evil and messy and negative people. With that said, again, I greet you in Jesus' joy. Sister Pinky, I think that we had about several people, brothers and sisters, who were in their 90s. We had two last week. Didn't we have another one this week? Who was that person? Now Miss Letha Mara, she's 90 years old. Now we have three of our members in their 90s. Aren't we blessed at this church? Three people that's in their 90s at this church. To God be the glory. So to all of the birthday people, before we sing to you, I wanted to share that we had several persons in our church. Our brother Turner, he lost his sister, and we funeralized her on Friday of this past week, this past Friday. We funeralized her. I was blessed to go down to Mount Bio to be with them on that short service of this past Friday there. And we also had Brother John. John offered, I believe he said he lost his brother-in-law. Sister-in-law and your nephew. Right. Or what? Nephew. And his nephew. Both of them died basically, what, in the same week or so?
Yes.
So we want to let everybody know, let's be in prayer for our brother John. He's a part of the Lynch Street family. Also, I believe we had another person. That was Betty Rimmer's what? Uncle that just passed. And we want to be in prayer for Betty Rimmer. And Donna Evans lost her aunt on her daddy's side. And we certainly want to be in prayer for all of those persons who are going through bereavement, not only at the Lynch Street family, but any other persons that's going through in these United States and world. And of course, God bless those persons that are struggling with the coronavirus. We are asking God to keep his hands on them as well. So to all of the birthday people, we want to just simply give you a hand clap, and all of those persons celebrating an anniversary, we want to give you a hand clap. If you all don't mind, let's put your hands together for the birthday in January and the anniversary in January. Thank you so very, very much. On tomorrow, some of you are going to have a day that we struggled hard to make make it permanent in the United States, called Martin Luther King Jr. Day celebration. Brother John, you already got your marching shoes on? Well, anyway, all I'm saying is I'm so happy that it has become, aren't you all, an official holiday in the United States of America, a Martin Luther King Jr. Holiday. So I just wanted to just say happy MLK Day to some of you. And that's what some of the message today will be geared around that of Dr. King, who was a master of social gospel. And he was influenced by the father of social gospel, the father of the social gospel movement in the United States, who was a German theologian by the name of Walter Rosenbusch. So we're going to talk a little bit about that as well. Thank you so very much. Those are our announcements for today, my brothers and sisters. We want to let you know we need your tithe. We need your offering. Would you please take a look at the screen? I have several ways that you can give. Cash App, other areas there. Take a peek at the screen. I want you to look at it very carefully because these programs that we're having today could not be possible without your tithe and without your offering. God bless you now and keep you is my prayer. At this time, we're going to ask our songbird to give us another selection. I'll come back from a word from our sponsor, and then we'll have the invitation and the doxology and benediction. Thank you.
Promise to heal our land.
wonderful, wonderful. There is no other way that we can live without the Word of God. We need to hear from you. There is no other way for us to live but by the Word of God. And notice I did not say warm fuzzies, nor did I say emotions. We need not warm fuzzies, not emotions. We need a let me break it down a little further. We need a 786,716 words, 33,301 verses, 1,189 chapters. That's what we need from you. Not warm fuzzies and not emotions. The only thing that's going to save you is the Word of God. I just said something very important. The only thing that's going to save you is the Word of God. The grass withers and the flower fades when the breath of God blows upon it. Surely we people are nothing but grass. The grass withers and the flower fades away, but the Word of God shall stand forever. That's what we need in this day and age. In this day and age, in this pandemic, what we need is a word from you. Let us pray. Lord, we need this word from you. And without this word, what would we do? In order for us to live, move, and have our beings, we need to hear from you. And how can we hear without a preacher? And how can that preacher preach except they be sent? In Jesus' name, amen. Let me ask y'all a question, a wonderful theological question. And it really bothers me. It concerns me a lot because I hear it in the Walmarts of the world. I hear it in the Krogers of the world. Amen. I hear it in parking lots of the world. Christians now, not non-Christians. But I'm hearing this for Christians, that Christians are so upset and wondering what in the world is going on. They're just surprised and just shocked about all of the outbreaks and all of the demonic forces that are going on simultaneously in the cosmos. Why are Christians shocked? Why are Christians surprised? Christians? Christ-like? Christians that are supposed to be blood-washed and blood-bought? Christians who are supposed to be connected to God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit? Christians who are supposed to have this word, and we are still shocked at all of the things that's going on right now? Christians? Something's wrong with that. We shouldn't be shocked. Scripture tells us over and over and over again the events that will happen, events that have happened in the past, prophecies that have been fulfilled. Scripture tells us where we are right now during this existential moment. And Scripture share with us what to look for during this end time that we are in as it relates to eschatology, the study of end times. And that's the reason, my brothers and sisters, right now that we're studying in Bible study, we're basically studying the entire book of Daniel. How interesting Daniel is, because it lends itself to eschatology. Not only Daniel, but we are going to go up through the Matthean gospel in Matthew, and we will end up in Revelation, which is the end of the 66th book, which is Revelation. that is the Bible. We don't have any business being shocked, because the Bible tells us in 16:33 of John, in this world you shall have trials and tribulation, but for us to be of good cheer, for he said, for I have overcome the entire world. I read you the text already today, Acts 5, 25 through 39, but the special emphasis will be on verses 38 and 39. Verse 38 says, anything of human origin that is not of God, and if you allow me to paraphrase it, if God is not in anything we do, it's going to fail. Verse 39 says, but if God is in it, that's the side we want to be on. Human beings can't stop it unless they fight against the very presence of God. Subject is simply this: if anything we do is not of God, it will fail. If anything we do is not of God, it will fail. When I start looking at the events of what has transpired these last 4 years, from 16 to 2020, is that it in terms of the 4 years that 44 plus one has been in office? And I'm just using him as an example, but when you start using that as an example, you can use other things as well. But right now, we've had two major events that has transpired in roughly about a 7-day period. That is the inciting of insurrection that has taken place at the People's House, at the nation's capital, and of course on the 13th, where we had the second impeachment of the same person. I hope that you can get something out of this. I'm not going to be very long at all today, but there is a word for everybody listening today. I just happen to use that particular current event during this existential moment. When you do stuff, or when I do things, stuff, however you want to call it, that is not godly, don't look for it to be successful. Does that make sense, John? Does that make sense, everybody? Don't look for it to be. I don't understand why Christians think that is going to be successful. It may take a long time. It may take a little while for it to kick in, or for God's word to kick in, or for God to do the inevitable in that bad situation. But trust and believe in this word that if God says it's going to happen, it's going to happen. So anything that is not of God is going to fail. Well, let's go back and look at the chronology for a minute as it relates to the election. And this stuff goes around the world. You got to be careful. It goes around the world, the whole wide world, because it goes on the YouTube. And you can see our YouTube, as you know. You can always go to the YouTube, go on to Lynch Street CME Church. And you got to be very careful, because you got to make sure everything is pretty factual. The first thing was that during the election, since this is a social gospel message today of Donald John Trump, first and foremost of all, I'm convinced the whole thing was wrong. You did not get elected fairly. It is proof within the United States that there was some Russians that helped to influence the election in 2016. Are those facts? I'm dealing with facts now. I'm dealing with facts. It's documented. FBI has it right now. It's documented. Department of Justice is there. It was not done properly. Person gets elected anyway. And for Christians to think that it was going to be a successful 4 years tells me that a person really don't understand this. Because if you understood this, this says in Galatians 6 and 7, be not deceived, God's not mocked. Whatsoever a man, woman, boy, or girl soweth, that shall a man, woman, boy, or girl reap. The book of Hosea says you sow the wind, but you reap the whirlwind. Now that don't mean, Brother Quinn, that everything has to be bad. If you sow good seeds, you're going to get good seeds. But if you sow bad seeds, you're going to get bad seeds. So how in the world can something be successful when it is not of God? That's first. Well, follow the chronology now. Get elected. God allowed, and it's all God. And by the way, the coronavirus, God did not cause it, but God allowed it. God allowed, okay, the House of Representatives to go Democrat 2 years later. Come on now, just follow it. That's all I want you to do is follow it. After that happened, during that 2 years, of talking about saying some things, sexism and racism and white supremacy and racist and all of this type, I think this is Martin Luther King Day, so I'm just speaking of Martin Luther King Day. All of this stuff that came out of his mouth was not good. God didn't appreciate talking about how you would grab women inappropriately. That's not God. That's the devil. And anything that's not of God, it's going to fail. Not only that situation, but in my life and in your life and anybody else's life, if it's not of God, it's going to fail. Lost the House now. 2 years later, lost the presidency. I just want y'all to follow it. I'm not dealing with no fiction. 84 million people voted for Joe Biden. That wasn't good enough. The devil never stopped. The devil keeps going. So I'm going to go through 60 different courts. And I'm going to go up 60 different courts, pay all of these millions of dollars and get all of my people riled up to support me in all the courts. And every last one of them, none of them came back saying it was illegal or anything was wrong with the election. It was legal, and why you want to overturn it, I don't know. I do know. I don't know. Yes, I do. I know it's the devil. That's why. The devil will not let go. Now, after that, or before that, after the House was in with the Senate, with the House of Representatives, now they have the House now. You no longer have that. And during that time, between the time of the House of Representatives being going to the Democrats and between the time of the next election, which is the presidency, now you've been impeached. You've been impeached, and do some of you all remember what it was, the impeachment? It'll go down in history. I'm not talking about the second time, but the first time. Does any of you remember? Right after that, when he was impeached, then lost the presidency. I'm just talking about stuff that's not of God now. Just following it on down. Now, now we lost the Senate. Now they're no longer the majority in the Senate. Well, I had Georgia. No, Georgia has now turned blue. Georgia has two senators that are blue. And the state of Georgia is blue. And Reverend Dr. Warnock and Ossoff could not be stopped. Verse 39 of the text says that if it's not of, but if it is of God, you can't stop it. Right after that, we had this major situation after the election was over on January the 6th, which will go down in history. Again, it's one of the most gruesome days in the United States of America. How, again, thugs. And I say that, and a lot of people don't want to hear that, but it's amazing to me that 44 plus 1 can say thugs, and I can't say thug. But it was amazing how thugs happened. Amen. It's amazing how he brought that thing up with how these thugs happened and how, you know, during the time of what was going on in the marches and when we were there by the tens of thousands of people and these thugs, y'all don't remember that? These thugs called it out. He said, these thugs. And I'm saying these thugs again. I'm saying thugs. These thugs. Went to the people's house and defecated, and urine was everywhere, all over the place. And this was a people's house that you and I pay for. Consequently, from January 6th to January the 13th, which is another historic day, was the second impeachment of Donald John Trump. He was the second impeachment. He was the first person in history to be impeached twice. We're living in some gruesome times. I'm trying to get you all to see, my brothers and my sisters, that we need to be careful, all of us, start with me, that if I continue to go down this road without God being in my life, I'm going to fail. Amen. I'm going to fail. It's as simple as that. There's no way in the world that you can make it without God. I brought this continuum. I brought these devastated continuum of things, of bad things that just happened one by one by one by one to show you that if anything that is not of God, it's going to fail. It may take a while, but it's going to fail. Well, I don't want to leave it there for you. I told you I wasn't going to keep you long today. Verse 39 says, but if it is God, you can't stop it. If it is God, you can't stop it. What are you saying, Reverend? What we're supposed to do as Christians is to make sure that we are in the will of God. I'm not in the will of God by warm fuzzies. I'm not in the will of God by emotions. I'm in the will of God by studying God's word. When it comes down to dealing with, as I shared last week, continuation of dealing with evil people, I don't base it on emotions. I don't base it on warm fuzzies. I'm basing it on, for example, Psalm 37. Fret not thyself because of evil. How many beside me know some evil people? Oh, come on. Now, you don't have to say the name. You might want to tell the truth. If you're my age and older, you've been around some evil, messy, evil, come on now, mean-spirited people. The Lord said, don't worry about that. Well, what you mean, Lord? How do I know that? Lord, just tell me how to do it. Do it through the emotion. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord. No, I know it through Psalm 37. Fret not thyself because of evildoers, for they will soon be cut off. They would be like grass that's withered. I don't know when God is going to do that, but I do know what God did say to me, fret not. Don't worry about it, because God has your back. As I think about evil people again, 2 Timothy 3, watch this now, 1 through 5 makes it clear. And I think you can parallel that with where I was going earlier. I hope so. How apropos for us to bring this up. And by the way, that selection, how apropos, we need a word from you. How apropos are doing this Martin Luther King Day. Amen? 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5. 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5. Mark this. Mark this. Think about this now that's going on right here in the world. There will be terrible times in the last days. Are y'all hearing this? I didn't make this up. This is God's word. There will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves. Uh-oh. Some of us don't care nothing about nobody but us. We ain't thinking about our wife. We ain't thinking about our children. The only thing we're thinking about is us. I, me, and mine. I love me and me only. People will be lovers of themselves. People will be lovers of money, 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 money. Money. Some people got to have it. Hey, hey, hey. Some people really need it. Coming to it now. Do thing, good thing with it. Do thing, bad thing with it. I'm talking about money. Talking about cash money. Hey, dollar bills, y'all. Come on now. Oh, yeah. For the love of money, people will live on it. For the love of money, people will laugh on their brother. For the love of money, well, people will even go to the street. What is it? You never know what the world ain't gonna meet. Better than me, uh-oh, green. Hey, mean green, almighty dollar. Dollar, I guess you said, this man is a complete fool. This is my friend out here. Thomas Audio. I'm giving him a little play out there for y'all hear how good this sound is. I want you to know Thomas Audio. Excellent job. He's doing an excellent job for us. Love of money. What did he start saying about their own mother? All that, right? Oh, because the love of money. Watch this now. I'm talking about 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5. The people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money. They will be boastful. Uh-oh. They'll be proud. I know some people like that. They will be abusive. Uh-oh. I know some people like that, talking inappropriately to women and them. I know folks like that, disobedient of their parents. They can be ungrateful. I know some people that's ungrateful. I know some folk, you know, I don't care what you do for them, they can't simply say ta-ta. Listen, thanks is the icing to the cake of life. I just said something very important. It don't cost nothing to say ta-ta. They're unholy. They're without love, without love, without love. I know a lot of people without love, unforgiving. I know a lot of people that's unforgiving and slanderous and without self-control and brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous and rash and conceited and lovers of the pleasure, lovers of pleasure rather than that of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. The Bible says when you see folk like that, have nothing to do with them. I'm just going by 2 Timothy chapter 3, 1 through 5. So you don't need nobody getting mad at me. I'm just telling you what the scripture said. Stay away from folk like that. You see it now? Get rid of you can get angry, but don't sin. Amen. Let me go on because I want to let you go today. But I do want to lift up a few more verses. In spite of it all, in spite of who they are, I hate to say it, it's an oxymoron, Brother Thomas. It's an oxymoron, Brother Hubbard, but we still have to love our enemies. All right, now y'all can say what you want to. I said what I said, but you still must love your enemies. Amen? Matthew chapter 5, 43 through 48. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be the children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise of the evil and the good and sends rain of the righteous and the unrighteousness. Watch this. If you love those who love you, then what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, that's folks you love, what are you doing more than anybody else? Do not even the pagans do that? The Bible said, be perfect, therefore, as your Father is perfect. That Greek word does not mean perfection that we know of. So you got to love your enemies. Amen. You must love your enemies. And please know this as I get prepared to leave today, that if it's not of God, it will fail. But if it is of God, you can't stop it. What are you saying again, Reverend? I'm saying that we need to make sure that we are on the right side, are in the will of the Bible, of the will of God. For Psalm 27 says, verse 1, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I not be afraid? When my enemies came upon me to devour my flesh, they stumbled and they fell. Well, in this text, as I close today, in our text, verses 38 and 39, there are some people that wanted Peter and the apostles killed. And when they had heard, they were enraged and wanted them killed because they didn't quite understand who these men were. And that's what happens to you, brothers and sisters, when you are under the anointing, when you are under the anointing of God, people don't know how to handle you. I just said something very important. They don't know what to do with you. Can I tell you something else? The devil don't know what to do with you when you just be quiet. Look, God is omniscient. God is all-knowing. You cannot tell me that God is going to share that power and that glory with any other being. Amen. God will always get the glory. Therefore, because you are, and God is omniscient, all-knowing, there's no way in the world that Satan can know everything you are thinking. Anybody tell you that, that's wrong. And I beg to challenge anybody, he can share that with me. Uh-uh, he doesn't know what you're thinking. Be quiet, watch it quit. The only time that he know what you are thinking is when you blurt it out of your mouth. For the life and death is in the power of the tongue. I just said something very important. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. I can sit up here right now and I could just be going through whatever I'm going through and I could just be doing like this, like I do sometimes throughout my life, and just be. Slewfoot not gonna know that. The devil not gonna know that, because the devil is not omniscient. He's not all knowing. But anyway, I'm going to wrap this up. Gamaliel simply said to them, to the group there in the Sanhedrin Council, if I were you all, said they had already shown, God had already shown these people. When you read the complete book of Acts, which I want you to do, particularly Acts 5, he had already shown them in Acts chapter 5 the power of God. Do y'all remember when those apostles were in jail? They had guards and everything around them, and next thing you knew, they were out. And they were out of jail, Peter and all the apostles, and they said, wait a minute now. I know that you all had some guards on the inside and some guards on the outside. How in the world can these persons get out? I can tell you, but God. When you are going through things in your life, but God. When the vicissitudes of life are raging and you can't see your way out, but God. God can do anything but fail, but God. So I want to let you know as I close, but God got him out. And Gamaliel said this, After he sent everybody else out, he said this to the Sanhedrin council. If I were you all, I would leave this crowd alone. It's something about them that's different. Put it this way. If what they have done that you all think is so bad, just go ahead and just whip them a little bit, flag them a little bit, frack them around, you know, do whatever you need to do, but don't kill them. Because what they do, if it's not of human origin, it's going to fail. But if it is of God, you can't stop it now unless you fight against the very presence of God. You need to just be on the right side of God. Make sure that whatever you do is of God. That way, when the devil come after you, there's not a thing the devil can do to you because it is not of God. It will fail. But if what you do is of God, the devil and other humans cannot stop it unless they fight against the very presence of Almighty God. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to just share word to your people. Help us to be on your side and not the devil's side. Help us to think about what's right. Hold on to what's right. Hold on to principle. Hold on the principle, which are you, Lord. Hold on the principle, which is you. Hold on the principle, which is the Bible. Methods are many. Principles are few. Methods change often, but principles never do. And as we hold on to that word, we will know that everything will be all right. In Jesus' name, amen. The doors of the church are wide open today. As you stand, please, the doors are open. What a great opportunity to come and to admit. You don't have to be a long prayer. Just say, Lord, I was on the wrong side. I was playing around with the devil. And notice that everything in my life was pretty much going downhill. And I just wondered what was going on. It's because I was serving the devil and not serving you. And every time that we serve the devil and don't serve God, it's going to fail. But when we serve God, even though the vicissitudes of life are going to rage, even though the Bible says no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Watch this. It did not say it wasn't going to form, and nor did that scripture say it wasn't going to prosper. I mean, it was not. It said at the end of the day, it won't prosper. No weapon formed. That's where I was trying to go with that. Weapon. It didn't say it wasn't going to be a weapon. Nor did it say it was going to form. That's where I was trying to go. But it won't prosper. There you go. It won't prosper because you belong to God and God is omnipotent. So if I were you, I would come. Just say, Lord, I want to be on your side and I want to be in your will. Forgive me for my sins. Accept me how I am. Romans 10 and 9 says, talks about this whole notion that you'll be saved. You believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The Bible says you'll be saved. That's all you gotta do. Look at the screen and we'll pray for you. What a great opportunity to come on this MLK celebration. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. You are more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. It said it wasn't going to be a weapon. And it didn't say it wasn't going to form. Just simply said it wasn't going to prosper. Yeah. back to church. Say amen. Thank you, God. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. If I were you all, I would leave these Christians alone because they're connected to God. It's a special anointing on this Christian. Touch not my anointing, nor do my prophets no harm. If I were you all, I'd leave these Christians alone, says Gamaliel to the Sanhedrin Council. Because if it is not of God, I'm telling you now, it's going to fail. But if it is of God and a thing you can do about it, you can't stop it unless you fight against the very presence of Almighty God. You just need to remember that whatever you do, that you stay in the will. You want to be in the perfect will of God. With that assurance, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon each of you and give you peace. 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 Right now. And forevermore. Activities. I know you're going to some. Social distance, 6 feet. Put those gloves on, put that mask on, and still enjoy your day. Just be safe. God bless you. Keep you is my prayer. Have a great day.
Yes, Lord. got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop.
I am a segregationist.
You love your little niggas, I love who I please.
I feel that nonviolence is really the only way, because violence is just so self-defeating. A riot ends up creating many more problems for the Negro community than it solves. You can, through violence, burn down a building, but you can't establish justice. You can murder a murderer, but you can't murder murder through violence. You can murder a hater, but you can't murder hate. And what we are trying to get rid of is hate.
Can we honestly say that it doesn't affect our security and the fight for peace when Negroes are denied their full constitutional rights?
We must come to see that the end we seek is a society at peace with itself. That will be a day not of the white man, not of the black man. That will be the day of man as man.
Segregation in public transportation will pass away. The Negro citizens will return to the buses on a non-segregated basis.
Things that are being done by you will make Birmingham a better city for everybody.
Color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream.
Bring the attention of the nation to this whole issue in Selma, Alabama.
What he's asking for is right.
How long? Not long.
Not long.
Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah.
And we as a people will get to the promised land.
Time has come for the president to sign an executive order outlawing segregation.
Register to vote.
We will speed up that day when all of our children, black men and white men, will be able to join hands.